Parasha-Meditation, Parashat Shemot. This meditation and its explanation is based on Rav Ginsburg. He had an audio lecture recorded live in Kfar Chabad, Israel, that was called Parashat Shemot from 2016. And it's really quite fascinating. And so we are now in the heart of winter here. And so this is the time when it's not Shemitah that we actually prune the trees and we go more into our roots to prepare ourselves for the renewed personal growth to as we emerge from the winter exile. So this week's Parsha, Parshat Shemot, is a new epoch for the Jewish people, the epoch of exile, a new book in the Torah. And I always thought it was quite amazing how important it is to be curious, to have a true intellectual and spiritual curiosity. Because if you think about it, had Moshe just passed by the burning bush without asking the question, how could it be that the bush is burning without burning away? A lot of times we may see things that are a little strange, but we're so busy, we don't think about it. We don't ask questions. We just walk by. But Moshe took his time to ask the question. And that's why Hashem revealed himself to him. And so we learn, if you want to have divine revelations, we need to ask questions. And this is what I do in life when I can't understand something in the Torah or in my life. Like I will ask, I'll put out the question, how can it be? You know, why is it written like this here and it's written like that over there? I always have a lot of questions. And even if I just ask the question to myself and I browse a bit for answers, different places, usually based on how burning my question is how quickly and how deep I'll get an answer. Somehow I'll get an answer. And it's also for things that happens in life. Like, why do I have to go through this and that? Why don't my, we have some problems with our son. And I asked Hashem, and yeah, you know why? Because it is for us, my husband and I, to get closer together in our marriage through all of this. Like, Hashem, just give me an answer like that because I asked. Anyway, and this is what we learned from Moshe. We have to ask. And that is what it says. It says specifically that it was only when Hashem saw Moshe questioned his wisdom and went to check out the paradox of the burning bush, that it was burning, but it was not burning away. It wasn't being consumed. That's when Hashem appeared and revealed himself to him. And so, and that's when the angel of Hashem appeared to him in a flame of fire from within the bush. He looked and there was a bush, all aflame, yet the bush was not consumed. Moshe said, I must turn aside now to look at this great sight. Why doesn't the bush burn up? That was Moshe's question. When Hashem saw, this is the part that I wanted to read to you, that he turned aside to look, God called to him out of the bush and said, Moshe, Moshe. He answered, here I am. So interestingly, the word for bush in Hebrew is sne. It appears for the first time in the Torah in this pasuk, and it appears actually five times, which called in this pasuk that, in this section, chapter 3 of Shemot, verse 2-4, and it parallels the five times that the word all, light, is mentioned in the beginning of creation, in the first chapter of Bereshit, verse Gimel to Hey. God said, let there be light, and there was light. God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. Then there was evening, then there was morning, day one. Altogether, it's five times. So this number five is a very important code number in the Torah. It also corresponds to the five books of Moshe, and it actually corresponds to the burning bush, which, according to the Midrash, had five leaves emanating from one point. This may remind us of the myrtle, which a kosher myrtle must have three leaves emanating from one point. And those three leaves correspond to Avram, Yitzhak, and Yaakov. Whereas the burning bush adds to this triad, Moshe and Aaron. It was in the zechut, in the merit of these five fathers with their wives, that the Jewish people were redeemed from exile. And each of these five correspond to five sfirot in the Torah, Abraham to Chesed, Yitzhak to Gvura, Yaakov to Tiferet, Moshe to Netzach, and Aaron to Hod. Each of these five fathers of shepherds, together with the embodying that particular sphira that they represent, teaches us another lesson about our life on earth and our connection with Hashem. So I'm just gonna paraphrase it quickly because it's quite long in my book. I really hope that you will purchase my Parasha-Meditations so you can get it on Amazon. If you can't find it, just email me or message me. So the first lesson is the lesson of Avraham, the lesson of Chesed, the lesson from the bush, five lessons from the burning bush. And that is Hashem's omnipresence includes the lowliest creations, even that little thorn bush, a low thorn bush. There's no place vacant of God. God is everywhere. That's Chesed, expansion. Hashem's presence is manifest through his holy fire. Even in a bush, even that little lonely bush is exuding Hashem's presence through the fire. And so that was the first lesson, more or less, that God's omnipresent, even in things that appear to be negative and lowly, like a burning, like a thorn bush, arouses and inspires us to come closer to God. Because that is the lesson of Chesed, the lesson of Hashem's omnipresent, the lesson of Hashem's oneness that permeates the entire world. All that we learn from this lowly bush. The second lesson is Yitzhak's lesson. Hashem participates in our pain. And this is what we know it says, Imo anochi betzara, I am with him in his troubles. Hashem is with us in our exile. Now we're focusing a bit more on the fire than on the bush. Like in this, now it's, first the burning bush represented all reality. And now the burning bush represents the Jewish people. The bush is experiencing pain through the fire, but yet Hashem is there in the midst of this pain. So that's gvura, courage, restraint. That's the lesson of pain that's represented by Yitzhak, who was blind, who went through a lot in his life, but Hashem is always with us in his pain. He's not just patting us on the back. He's actually experiencing the core of our pain. B'chol tzaratam li lo tzar. In all their troubles, he, Hashem, experiences pain. Hashem suffers together with his people. He wants us to feel that he is with us. This gives us faith that he definitely will redeem us. The third lesson is now Yaakov, the paradoxical coexistence of fire and bush. Like that, you know, how come that there's a fire in the bush, but the bush is still existing? The bush is not being consumed. Two opposite. It's a dialectic, it's a paradox. two opposites exist simultaneously. This is an enigma. The bush was burning, but the bush was not burning away. We have to learn to hold these two opposites at the same time. That's how we get to truth. And that's what Yaakov represents. Tiferet, the perfect harmony of two opposites, that perfect blend and peace between them. And also Yaakov is emet, ish emet is truth. That is the truth. Every time we think, oh, truth is only to the right, and we forget about the left, or we think about the left and forget about the right, we're only seeing partial truth. The coexistence and harmony of opposites is Tiferet, and that's also the beautiful and the compassion of Yaakov. And Yaakov actually performed all kinds of scientific experiments to understand and discover the root and the phenomenon of nature. He understood God by understanding the wonders of nature. Yaakov's witnessing reality, the bush was burning but not burning away, is a manifestation of the character trait of compassion, which Yaakov embodies. Now we move to the fourth leaf of the burning bush that corresponds to Moshe. The Jewish people will never be consumed. Now the burning bush corresponds to who? No other than the Jewish people. The fire is no longer a symbol of God, but of the servitude of Egypt. This fire is attempting to consume and burn away the Jew, but the bush state withstands. It can never succeed in burning out the Jewish soul, for the Jewish people are eternal and nothing is going to consume us. The eternity of the Jewish people derives from being part of God himself. And this is also the character trait and the sphere of Moshe, eternity, Netzach. The bush, which represents the Jewish people, corresponds to eternity, victory, which is embodied by Moshe, who emerged victorious from Pharaoh's wrath and brought us to also the eternal Torah. Now, the last of the five petals is the most difficult lesson to understand. And please, Hashem, help me to explain it good. This is about the Jewish soul never expiring. And there's another paradox coming up here. This is represented by Aharon. Because when we, the Jewish soul, meditates upon the truth of God's essential changelessness and eternity, completely transcending the physical, constantly changing reality, this meditation will naturally bring the Jewish soul to spiritual consumption called in Hebrew kalot ha-nefesh, making the soul leave the body altogether. There's only God. You know, that's why we say Shema Yisrael, when that's supposed to be the last word we say before going to sleep, depositing our soul with God, and it's supposed to be the last word on a Jew's lips, his last breath before passing away. The oneness of God, there's only God, and so the soul gives itself over to that oneness, and then the soul no longer, and then becomes part of that oneness, and then it must leave the body. But this is not what happens to the Jewish people on a, you know, in general. We have that ability, and that's a paradox, to completely, you know, give ourselves over to the oneness of God while still being within the body, remaining within the physical body. And that is kind of a miracle. So it's like, how can a Jew so meditate in depth about God's essential transcendence, changelessness, and eternity without leaving the body? So there's two things that we learn about in Kabbalah and Chassidut. There's the ratzo, running. So the soul is running to cleave to the oneness of God, and then there's shov, returning. If it was only running, we would not come back to our body. That's what happened to Aaron's sons, and they were consumed by a strange fire. But because we also have something that's called shov, returning, and the returning is that the soul does not expire when it experiences God's absolute transcendence. It comes back. It must come back to its body. This is God's will. And so the fire now in this image is a positive fire, representing the fire of God's absolute transcendence. Each time the fire is something else. In level four, the fire was the fire of exile of the Egyptians and the pain. And in level two, it was the pain. So it keeps switching. The ultimate greatness of the Jewish soul represented by the bush is that it never expires. Because Hashem desires that the Jewish soul remains on earth within the body to fulfill Hashem's will. And that is the sphere of Hod, sincerity and acknowledgement, walking simply with God, with dedication and thanksgiving. Acknowledging the divine eternal presence that's represented by Aaron, the Kohen Gadol, the high priest, who was able to enter the Holy of Holies while his soul still remained within his body. And this represents this last aspect of the fivefold unity of the holy soul, of holy souls. And now, so this number five also corresponds to the strong hand of Hashem that took us out of Egypt. Hashem's redemptive hands, which has five fingers, also corresponds to the two tablets with each five commandments on each of them. And it corresponds to the fivefold revelation of the five lights of creation that we started discussing and the five books of Moshe. Each book represents one of these lessons, actually, which is actually quite exciting. The first book, Bereshit, is the book of the Avot, of the forefathers, and it represents Chesed. We learn so much about all the kindness and the Chesed that our patriarchs and matriarchs did in the book of Bereshit. And then you have the second book, is about all about exile. It did, you know, Shemot, the beginning of the and the pain of the Egyptian exile, and how Hashem's presence escorted us throughout our 40 years wandering in the desert. It's about how Hashem is with us in our pain. The book of Vayikra reflects the coexistence of the divine and the human through the sacrifices in the tabernacle that connects us. And then we have Bamidbar, which is about the eternity of the Jewish people, despite our manifold sins that we have, and that we continue to commit in the desert. And still, even though, because of that, the majority of the men have to die in the wilderness, nevertheless, we still survived. This is Netzach. The book of Dvarim reveals how you can live within the body of the holiness of the land of Israel, at the same time unifying to the highest degree with the spiritual divine. You're running to be one with Hashem in the Holy Land, but you are deeply rooted within the physical Holy Land that is a paradox that holds together the most physical with the most spiritual. So the five books of Moshe, the five revelations of divinity, become even more potent and manifest through the lesson of the burning bush. And now for the meditation. Make yourself comfortable in your chair or cushion and take five deep breaths. Close your eyes, relax, and meditate on an image of the burning bush. As you continue breathing, stay longer with each breath and relax even more. Imagine the warmth of the burning bush fire flowing through your body. Notice a white, comforting light emanating from the bush. You can only see and feel this light when you take the time to stop and relax. The light is in the bush. The light is in you, warming you, healing you, surrounding you with white light, with a sense of unity with all of God's creation. Focus on the image of the bush with all of its thorns. Allow yourself to feel the pain of the thorns penetrating into your flesh, and remember the pain of the many thorns in your life. Breathe into the pain of your life and let it melt away as you visualize how Hashem's presence is with you, right there in the core of your pain. Imagine the paradox of the thorn bush burning with a fire and flame without being consumed. Visualize before you the thorny branches that remain intact, even as they are surrounded by flames of fire. Allow yourself to observe this paradox without judgment. Just let it pass through you as you accept the many paradoxes you have experienced in your life. Visualize the bush amidst the fire without being consumed. Connect with the challenges in your life that you have overcome. Each challenge has made you grow stronger. Trust that regardless of which hardship you may face, you will endure and become more refined in the process. Imagine you are the bush within the flaming fire. You are a speck in Hashem's eternal omnipresence. Your soul is only a spark of the divine. Your own individual existence could easily evaporate within the infinite, all-encompassing, fiery soul. Yet even as you meditate on God's absolute existence that includes your very existence, your soul remains below without expiring into the flames of divine fire. Your continued existence embodies the experience of the burning bush that isn't consumed. Now zoom in on the fivefold leaves of the burning bush. Envision the five leaves growing out of one common point on the branch. The entire bush is filled with leaves that come in groups of five, all emanating from the same sewers. Allow the five aspects of this meditation to flow through you. First, the fire of divine omnipresent light surrounding you. Second, re-experience the pain of the thorns while feeling Hashem's comforting presence within your pain. Third, observe the paradox of the coexistence of bush and fire. Note the wonder of our paradoxical reality without judgment. Fourth, trust in your ability to overcome all the thorns and challenges in your life. Fifth, meditate on being a ray of Hashem's light or a drop in the ocean without vanishing away in the greater whole. As you inhale, visualize the bush. As you exhale, visualize the fire, burning it without burning it away. Repeat four more times. When you're ready, you can tap your fingers on the table and your feet on the ground and gradually open your eyes.